The dawn greeting of the King of Beasts rings clear across grassveld, woodland, and flay, close to Capricorn, where the great rivers glide slowly to distant seas. Gradually, daylight tints haze blue mountain, bush green, and river brown. The fish eagle, lord of the African skies, soaring in lofty majesty high overhead, wide wings stretched free, head thrown back for the challenging call. Out over the open grassland across the river, a crested koran rises steeply skywards above his nesting territory, proclaiming it for all to know with loud beak clacks and whistling call. The black-headed oriole, a brilliant yellow bird of woodland and forest, greets the day from atop a noble white-thorn acacia. In the lower branches, the white-breasted sunbird, with its long, curved bill, prepares to go flower probing for nectar. The yellow-billed hornbill's mating call. He is perched amid the butterfly wing leaves of a mopane tree, speaking his love with wings raised and head bowed below his feet. At nesting time, the male hornbill seals his mate safely in a tree hollow, leaving only a narrow slit through which he feeds her. During incubation, she molts almost completely. Through open woodland towards thicker undergrowth and the towering forest trees nearer the water. The purple-crested lory, a raucous call, but a beautiful bird, resplendent in red and blue, green and purple. Thank you. the excited chitter of a flock of Cape glossy starlings, morning sunlight glancing from their shiny green plumage as they gather on an umbrella thorn already casting clear, sharp shade. Out on the hot grass belt, where the trees thin, a pack of wild hunting dogs. Savage, voracious predators, they can bring down antelope as large as kudu, racing alongside, tearing pieces off their victim till it collapses and is ripped apart by the pack, alive. The wild dogs have scented a rusty-spotted genet lying up for the day in a tambuti tree. Just out of reach, the genet growls and spits defiance at the leaping yellow forms below. The genet is a nocturnal hunter about the size of a cat. The hunting dogs, pricking their peculiar, rounded ears that distinguish them from any other canine, lope away across the veldt, leaving a chill of fear in the noonday heat. The African sun blazes high in a yellow-white dazzle, and wildlife seeks shade, listless. The emerald-spotted wood dove's mournful lament floats on waves of shimmering air. My mother is dead, my father is dead, all my relatives are dead, and my heart cries. So some translate this monotonous intonation, a characteristic sound of the bush. A male ostrich, largest living land bird in the world. The hen moves off her nest, a mere depression in the sand, exposing a clutch of about 18 eggs. The cock is a big bird, 8 feet tall. Something is disturbing them. A bird? No, that's an excited cheetah, fleetest of all animals. Still now, crouching in the tall grass, slit eyes alert on its favored prey, ostrich. The sudden, harsh, go away cry of the grey lurie. The ostriches speed off. Handsome, strange animals, cheetahs. The young contract their claws, cat-like. But with maturity, these become fixed, like the nails of a dog. The resinous rattle of the greater honey guide. It uses this call to attract and lead the honey badger to a wild beehive, there to expose wax, honey, bee grubs, and larvae, which badger and honey guide share. The guide calls become more excited. The hive is near, on the edge of the dense forest towards the water. Deep in the riverine forest, the fierce sunlight changes to a cool, aqueous green. The heavy dankness of soft vegetation mingles with the clinging scent of jasmine creeper. The Nerina trogon, a shy, beautiful bird, dweller amongst the enshrouding foliage of giant trees. The trogon, like some other birds, is ventriloquial, and as further disguise, it may perch to look backwards over the shoulder, hiding the strikingly brilliant red of the breast. The alarm barks of a baboon troop and the chatter of vervet monkeys agitate the forest. Away they go, swinging warily clear of a mahogany tree. Leopard, lying about 20 feet up, where he's wedged his most recent kill, a young impala doe, hauled high among the branches by brute strength. The leopard hunts with extreme stealth and cunning. At bay, one of Africa's most dangerous carnivores. Best left to eat alone. One of the commonest migrant birds of woodland and forest, the red-chested cuckoo. Hour upon hour in spring, summer, and autumn, day upon day, and often on moonlit night, Pitmafro calls. Like all cuckoos, it is parasitic, especially on robins, laying one egg to a nest. After throwing out the host chicks, the young cuckoo takes food gluttonously from the smaller adult robins. One of the finest songsters and best mimics in all Africa, the elusive little Natal robin, a dweller in thick bush and forest, often heard, rarely seen. Like most robins, a beautiful bird, rufous shaded, with blue-gray speckled wings and back. A fish eagle in the thick of the forest? No, that's the Natal robin in perfect mimicry. Jock of the Bushveld? No, the Natal robin again. Elephant heading for the nearby watering place. A pair of wattled plovers guarding their nest on the ground near the riverbank. The nest is directly in the path of the oncoming elephant herd. Both birds take to the air with a screaming, swooping attack to divert the herd. The leader pauses a pace from the nest, growls, turns clear of the three mottled eggs, and followed by the herd, moves in lofty grey eminence down to the water, leaving the nest warm and unharmed. A strange, watery outpouring call, characteristic of African flay and stream, Burchell's cuckoo, a skulking bird. Russet-winged, it glides in heavy flight over the reeds and water where the elephants splash and drink in the hot mid-afternoon, some trumpeting with the cool water in their trunks. Leaving the drinking place, the elephant disturbs several crocodiles basking near the water. With a waddle and a powerful tail flick, they slide into the river. Strange twangs originate some 12 inches below the hot sand of the river bank. Baby crocodiles forcing their way out of the buried eggs, about 45 in clutch. Now the game herds come to quench long thirsts. First, blue wildebeest, the brindled gnu. The wildebeests call when communicating. The higher pitched, plaintive location bleat of calves separated from their mothers in the crush at the drinking place. A herd of Burchell's zebra approach the water, uttering their odd, high-pitched barking call. The impala alarms note. Wildebeest and zebra also sense danger. All are still, heads pointing towards a lurking, tawny shadow. There she is, a big lioness, motionless, nerves tensed. A faint breeze swings in her favor, and she eases herself down into the cover of the long grass. The herds relax once more and continue their drink. Crested barbet. The dry, rattling call comes from amidst the shining green foliage and sweet-scented flowers of a mahogany tree across the water. Great spreading branches giving welcome shade in the day's heat. The puffback shrike, a small black and white bird perched on a masasa tree. The white back plumes are puffed out in excitement. party of Chacma baboons rambling along the riverbank, rooting and stone-turning for food. A great delicacy is the scorpion, and they are adept at first nicking off the deadly sting. Baboon danger cry. A tawny streak breaks cover in attack. Stampede. All have gone in a spatter of mud and thunder of flurrying hooves. All, save one wildebeest, a victim of tooth and claw. And as the dust settles, the kill is dragged to the shade of the great fever tree, where the lion pride share a meal, not without argument. Lazily licking jaw and paw, the lions rest beside the carcass, the first sharp pangs of hunger satisfied. Clear, liquid notes of the white-browed robin greet the first shades of dusk. Adult hippos leaving the daylight safety of the deep pools, their baby calves with them. The hippopotamus often suckles its young underwater. Sunset offers the relief of a gentle breeze as they begin grazing on the banks and in the shallows where the tiny painted reed frogs awaken to the evening hour. The male, clinging to a reed with suckered feet, inflates his huge vocal sac, calling his silent mate. Heavy flight, on broad, rounded wings, the hardy-dar ibis call, flying across the placid water to roost. Big Impala ran. He utters these extraordinary aggressive snorts in the rutting season, proclaiming his territory. Other rams, who dare trespass, are challenged, and a head-on fight may rage till one male gives ground in defeat. Leaving its inverted sleeping position, 70 feet or so above the bush, amidst the branches of a giant sycamore fig tree, the epauletted fruit bat wings into the night, emitting its specialized metallic sonar clink, clink. The pings, reflected from objects in the bat's path, are picked up as an echo by the highly sensitive hearing system. The bat thus guides itself safely in erratic flight amongst the branches in search of fruit, its principal diet.
Mm.
the location call of a black rhinoceros calf browsing in deep vegetation on acacia pods and other branch foliage. The call indicates the calf's whereabouts to its mother. Black rhinos are smaller and more aggressive than the white species. They're on the move. Again, unlike the white rhino, whose calf runs or is pushed ahead of its mother, black rhino calves trot behind. The mournful, distant howl of the black-backed jackal, a ripple of fear in the night. They've scented the lion kill. The voice of the spotted eagle owl, black-beaked and taloned, awakes a tremor of ghostly things as it prepares the night-long search for mice and moles, rats and shrews, scorpions and lizards hiding on the earth below. The side-striped jackal yaps from the dense bush. A relatively uncommon species, rarely seen in daylight, it lives on carrion and is a predator of rodents. Stealthy, soft-padded, hunting with infinite cunning amid the blackness of thick bush. Above, the plea of the South African nightjar, the litany bird. The call is likened to the words, "Good Lord, deliver us." Again, it offers its prayer as the disk of the moon glides clear of the trees. The lions are at their kill again, eating. Ringing the lion pride, moving ever closer, the jackals are joined by several spotted hyenas. With screeches, screams, and cackles, they make hideous the noisome night. At last, perhaps driven by the unceasing sounds of the hyena horde, the lions abdicate, leaving the remnants of the carcass to these scavengers of decaying flesh and breakers of bones. Mm-hmm. Piercing, sharp cry of the large gray bush baby tears at the night. Saucer-eyed, staring, it is another creature of the darkness. The eerie call of the tiny, buff-spotted flufftail, seldom seen, skulking in the marshes at the river bend, hooting into the dank wraiths of pre-dawn mist. Now the hyenas pad away, slavering, loose-jawed, into thick cover to lie up through the burning hours of another African day. A day whose light once more brings color to life. From the top of the fever tree where the lion kill lies, a rattling cisticola awakes to the day. The weird call of the trumpeter hornbill as it wings away through the open woodland. As the sun tops the trees, a stark shadow brushes the carcass near the fever tree. Another sweeps across it. And many more. With heavy wing beat and ungainly bump, the vultures lumber into their dance of destruction. With talon and hooked beak, they tear at the carcass voraciously, their movements gradually slowing as they become gorged with flesh. The vulture carrion stagger red-beaked, heavy-bellied, and sag-winged skywards as the lion, king of beasts, greets the sun. A greeting matched from above by the fish eagle, lord of the African skies, close to Capricorn, where the great rivers glide slowly to distant seas.